sensation at the moment is flossing. Does anyone know what flossing is? What is it?
You're going to share us.
What is it?
A dance.
It's a dance. And where did it come from? So it came from social media. Have you seen the little group that started it? And how come it's got so big? So social media, what happened? Yeah, people shared it. Katy Perry put it on a video and it like went really big. So I was like, right, I'm going to try and have a go. So I said, go like this. And so am I doing it right? Is it like this? Does anyone know how to do it? Who's here? So this is like what Three Conversations is kind of like when you're a social worker and I'm a principal social worker trying to work out how come this thing's got so big, where did it come from, all these questions. You start doing Three Conversations and people are saying, am I doing it right, is it like this? But by the end of the year, and maybe by the end of today, I might be able to do some proper flossing. So I'm going to talk about the journey so far in Worcestershire, issues and some of the stories of difference. There was no flossing involved. So I started in Worcestershire in April, 2 weeks before the start of the first Three Conversations innovation site started. And I was thinking, wow, this is like really exciting. It looks really innovative. Like, this organisation is brave to do this. They're taking risks. This is like the forefront of social work. And I was kind of excited about it. And then I was like, damn, my job as principal social worker is to make sure quality's there, that we still have social work values. So I had like a niggling doubt about it. But I thought, you know, see what happens. So the first two sites, lots of things started happening, and the pace of change was like really fast. So initially, on the other side, we launched like two teams initially. Then after a while, we like evaluated how that was going, and then we launched some other teams. And I was thinking, okay, yeah, keep the innovation sites in like a nice, safe environment, like a community team, because we know what happens. These guys were like, right, let's do it in the hospital, let's do it in transition. I was like, transition is like, you know, you've got to work for children, you've got to know adults. I was like, these guys are being brave and they're actually doing it. So I spoke to some of the local authorities, it was the Essex who were the first guys, and they just seemed really calm about it, and they're just like, you know, just go for it, it's going to be fine. And everyone else was just like, I don't know what you're talking about, how's that going to work? But for some reason, if you've got passion and drive, things can just happen and work. So I went to like the first two innovation sites and I spoke to social workers, and within the first couple of weeks it was just like, some of the social workers were like, I don't know what I'm doing. Some of them were like, oh, this is brilliant, I know exactly what I'm doing. The next week it would be like, I'm not managing duty very well, there are some barriers, but every week we're going to work out how we're going to overcome these barriers. We're not just going to put them on a piece of paper and leave them, we're stuck here, we're going to fight through those things. So it's a real roller coaster for social workers. Then they started to say, like one of the social workers, am I doing it on the right form? Should this be here? Is this good practice? And then the next week was like, this is what I need to be doing. So an exciting time. So to make it happen, you've got to have this like consistency balance with allowing innovative freedom. So if you let one team do what they need to do real social work again, how can you make sure that if we spread the love of Three Conversations across the whole authority, how can we make sure consistency happens? So these are still questions that we ask ourselves. Then we have like defining conversations 1, 2 and 3. So social workers were like, I've got a form, one this week four times, and it was, you know, trying to find out what their networks were. Do I put that in one? Do I put it in one long form, or do I open a new one and open another one? So there was a lot of that kind of conversation. We then had this embracing speaking to light blue, and some of the social workers took this literally. And I'm not going to go away. And that meant sometimes that they weren't closing cases. Well, case, not that to say, case. But they had so much glue and so many people that they were supporting. So we had to kind of change the language a little bit. So we changed that to, I'm there for you when you need me. So that helped us work that out. Then you've got to help embed the culture change. So every week I went into work, I didn't know where teams were. You know, people were excited, they were moving offices, people were starting innovation sites. I'd have to constantly catch up with people. And that kind of meant communication is really key. You have to, it didn't matter how much we communicated what was happening, it seemed that it's still not enough. I don't know why that is. You kind of, if you're part of some kind of change, you're excited, but if you're on the outside, you get worried about it, you're not sure what it means for you. So that's something that we still got to do. Time is all the teams, you've got all those band words, so you've got to sit together and work out what you mean as a social worker again. And to do that, you need lots of time. You need time to shape your attitudes, change things, think about things and flip them and reverse them to make them mean something to you as a team. So whilst those teams are doing that, the rest of the organisation still has to flow with you, so you've got to give enough space for that. And then we've got workflow and guidance, the changes that happen, people still want something on a piece of paper. It's got to change the words that we use in our policies to have this three conversation, how am I making it happen? So as a principal social worker, I think a lot of my work is about, this is happening, but how do I know that your supervision template is three conversations now? How do I know that you're doing great piece of practice when your form is a blank piece of paper? So those are the things I need to do. So also we had to evaluate things and see what it was like. And I think generally people were really positive about it in the first two innovation stages. People said, we're a bit stuck on duty because how are we going to make duty work? We need some occupational therapists. So the organisation was okay, let's see how we can get this happening and working. So social workers can listen to a little bit more. This is the same as the one that you saw previously. So about the number of conversations that happen. So this is now, but previously, this is with includes hospital team, CHC, and sensory impairment team. What's happened is, previously, the conversation two was a bit lower, it was 17%, and that generally is the kind of style of work that a hospital will do. It's more crisis and people who are in an unstable environment, so maybe the figures have changed because of that. But we'll have a keep watching it and seeing what happens, but it's all really positive. So what next? We have to work out what we're going to call reviews. So, and three conversation of those. And we thought, someone said, I know, we'll call it taking stock. And everyone was that sounds a bit of a big answer. we'll keep reviews maybe. So, and then it's how is that going to happen? Are we going to have social workers doing them? They're going to be conversation ones. Then it's carers assessments, we need to do that as well. So there's lots of things to snowball effect where we've got a few teams that are in the three conversations model, and it's like a real balance now. We have to go all the way or not at all. And so here we're going to have to embrace more change and just kind of, I suppose, just go for it, I guess, just see what happens. And so we're at the stage now, we're in a consultation period where job roles and teams are going to change a bit so that three conversation model can fit in a little bit more. We've got some partner agencies. So I work at Worcestershire University, and the students that I support, I'm teaching them about this because this is the future of social work. And I think we need to do more of that so that, you know, they're sensitive to the changes. And then we've got to, all our providers, we've got to explain to them how we're going to be different. I think another challenge is about with the NHS, because the NHS have got these pathways, pathway one, DTOC, BTOC, I don't even know all the words anymore, and they've got this streamlined train that's going straight down the middle, and it's like, okay, let's get three seats, let's jump on the train, or we've just missed it, we've got to try and fit in a little bit. So those are real challenges that are going to come through. So I'll do one story of difference. Once we've got time. So I just wanted you to think, you know, everyone's saying, is this what we do? Are we doing anything different? So a guy called Jim, he's got a learning disability, and he's got epilepsy and ASD, and he like lives in supportive living, and he's got 24-hour care and one-to-one support, and the health professionals are saying he needs waking night support with one-to-one as well because of his seizures, because they're quite frequent. So when his care's in place, he absconds quite a lot. He doesn't engage very well with his support, and he's physically aggressive towards staff. And the social worker met with Jim, and it was at the beginning of the conversations, she realised that basically he felt quite restricted by being with staff all the time. So, and there was no real evidence about the frequency of all these seizures. So she arranged an embrace like wristwatch, which would send them, it looks at like physiological symptoms that someone has to say when they might have an epileptic seizure. So this would send a message to her smartphone, and then that would alert a carer to come support him. And the phone has to only be 3 metres away from him, so that was good. So they tried that, but he had three different providers for his support. This is quite big. So they had to work out a centralised way of passing this phone to the right people at the right time. So that kind of worked. And the phone basically held data so that you were able to work out the actual frequency of the seizures for him. And then basically they used a direct payment to look at the data and prove how often his seizures are going to be. It's likely that he's not going to need that night support that's one to one. And then I was thinking,